It's day five of the Formula Kite European Championships here in Marmanor, Spain, and we can't wait to bring you the action today. My name's Andy Rice, and with me is one of Britain's best kiteboarders, Jimmy Craythorne. Jimmy, what kind of breeze have we got today? What can we expect?
So at the moment, it's about 14 to 16 knots. So, I mean, it's looking pretty glamour out there. We'll probably see everyone on 15 meter kites, but it could increase and it could get a little more spicy. So we'll see what the day has for us.
It's always been a difficult choice of kite this week. We've seen a variety of conditions and some days riders changing through a quiver of, say, three different kites. Do you think it's going to be a consistent 15, or will we see some chopping and changing on the beach today?
That's true. It's been a good event so far. We don't often have events like this where we see riders on every single kite, and it really draws out who is the best of the best. I think at the moment, it feels like a no-brainer with what kite they're going to be on. But I mean, I hope it builds. It's always exciting when the wind's a bit stronger, the speeds are faster, and the action is just even more intense.
All right. Well, Jimmy and I are going to get into the studio. We're going to be bringing you the first race very soon. We've got four men's gold fleet races, four women's gold fleet races. So back to you shortly.
The first 4 days of competition have set the stage for an intriguing showdown on the final weekend. While the French refuse to actually confirm that this event is part of their Olympic selection trials, the big giveaway is just how intensely the top French women are battling at the front of the fleet. Between them, Lauriane Nolot, Poema Newland and Jessie Catman are dominating the podium positions. On the strength of her standout performance throughout 2023, reigning world champion Nolot would be the obvious pick for Paris 2024. But Newland and Catman are giving the French selectors a headache by sailing every bit as fast and as furious as Nolot herself. Behind the French trio, Ellie Aldridge has the luxury of knowing she's already been chosen to represent Great Britain at the Olympic Games. She's the defending European champion from last year, but admits she's struggling to match the flat-out boat speed of the French in the flat water conditions of Marmanor. Elena Langvila has been a revelation at this regatta. A year ago, the Swiss rider said she couldn't even complete a jibe in most conditions. But on the super windy day three of this competition, the last day of the qualifying phase, Langvila won a race and is looking faster day by day. Others to watch include Daniela Moroz from the USA. The six-time world champion has not been at her best over the past year, but is using this regatta to test different equipment in the final run-in to Paris 2024. Lots of other intriguing battles to follow as well, including the Israeli trials with Gal Zuckerman currently leading Maya Ashkenazi. No surprises to see Max Maeder holding the lead in the men's fleet. The reigning world champion from Singapore almost never puts a foot wrong, and he's sailing as powerfully as we have come to expect from this determined 17-year-old. Behind Maeder, the points are very close indeed. Defending European champion Riccardo Pianozzi holds second spot, but just behind him is Axel Mazzella from France. Both of these riders are competing for Olympic selection, and the pressure on the beach and on the water has been there for everyone to see. Valentin Bontas was the surprise package of last year's Worlds when the fun-loving Austrian finished in fourth place. After a winter of hard training, the question for many was, had the class clown really stepped up a gear, or was that standout performance at The Hague just a flash in the pan? Judging by what we've seen so far in Marmanor, Bontas is the real deal. He sits in fourth with every prospect of moving up to the podium. Bruno Lobo from Brazil is in fifth, the knee surgeon taking time away from the hospital back home to focus on his campaign for a medal in Paris. He has really looked at home in the windier conditions of day three, and the Brazilian is certainly one to watch on the final weekend. Just behind him, Britain's Conor Bainbridge seems to be rediscovering the podium form he held a couple of seasons back. Yet to qualify his place at the Games, Bainbridge has a lot to prove to himself, and Marmanor is the ideal place for him to re-establish his credentials as a podium contender. Many others to watch in this talent-packed fleet include Croatia's Martin Dolenc and Germany's Yanis Maus.
So that gives you a flavour of the story so far after the first 4 days of competition. And it's a 15 square metre kind of day, as we've just said. Now there, Jimmy, there is one name from the men's fleet that you might have wondered, why are they not here? Why are they not here? Ooh. Well, that is because he's joining us in the studio. And so let's find out who the Stig is. Who was our mystery commentator that we previewed on Instagram yesterday? It's none other than Tony Vodicek.
Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah, coming in a little late, but I'm here now to watch everybody compete, giving it their all. And it's a blast trying something else now with the media guys. So hope we'll have an amazing day, some awesome races and some close battles.
Tony, we're honored to have you here, but the obvious question is, why have you chosen to sit here in the tent? Why are you not out there racing? This is Olympic year. Surely you need the race practice.
For sure. But with the team, we've decided that this was not the event to start at. We made a plan. We're sticking to it. Coming in next one is Palma. So this is why I'm skipping this one. I came now to spectate for the last 2 days for the weekend. And there we need to find the balance between racing and having fun. So you need to enjoy life and enjoy what you're doing. And I'm a firm believer, if you do one thing too much, it gets hard.
Yeah. You talked about racing and having fun. Some people might think that racing is having fun, but what's your definition of having fun?
My definition of having fun for sure is racing. That's why I'm even here doing it. I'm loving every minute of it on the water. But I do believe that you need proper preparations before it. And I'm only going to go in the water when I feel 100%. So I'm getting there. The process is long. It's started immediately after last year's Worlds. And yeah, spent a lot of time in Australia training in the summer in the hot weather. But I'm here. I'm feeling really strong. I'm feeling really good, especially looking at the guys racing out there. I do feel a little regret not being on the water with them. Can't wait to race with them.
And you're training in Australia. You did that with Cameron Maramanides from Greece. And you guys, according to Cameron, and I don't know if you could confirm this, you weren't always the best of friends. How is it that former, I don't know if enemies is too strong a word, but you guys didn't always see eye to eye, and now you're training toe to toe?
I wouldn't go as far as to say enemies would never be enemies. I would say that we were both one of the strongest guys in the TTR. We were competing hard against each other, and I think we were very young back then. I know we were very young. I think that was a little bit of a thing back then. We were very young, inexperienced, and just didn't get to see it. But now we see the bigger picture. We see we're both really nice guys. We have similar interests, same goals, and what's the better way to do it than do it together? And he's, like he said, also, we're very good friends. And the last year when I saw him again after some time, I think he came back as a changed man. He's down to earth, very nice, friendly. And if you guys get to meet him on the beach, somebody new listening to this, definitely go and say hi.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. Jimmy, what makes Tony stand out as one of the greats in men's kiteboarding?
Well, that's a good question. Well, I was just about to say, you could almost write a book about that whole scenario of Cameron and Tony. Tony, I don't know where to begin. You've always had speed. I think from ever since I've known you, you've always been absolutely one of the fastest out there. And just seeing you kind of bring it together over the years has been impressive. And let's see the rest of your fleet in Gold Fleet head into the start line for this first race.
So we've got four races up for the men, four races for the women, and we are just starting to come into Gold Fleet race one for the day. And let's see if anyone can take the battle to Max Mader. We got 5 seconds to go, and let's see if it's going to be a clean start. Max Mader from Singapore currently leading the event. And we'll wait to see if there are any port tax starters. There looks like there are 5 or 6 port tax starters. Tony, how much do you favor the port tax start approach?
I'm not super big of a fan. Also, my dad is always saying, stick to the right, be confident, go with the group, get clear air, and have fun. Because the left is like lottery, if you ask me, and I really don't like to gamble. I try to make my own luck with the speed I've got and the experience I've accumulated over the years. So looking here at the guys now, it's the guys to the left, they can be and can come amazingly in front, but it's better to be with the group. And if you're with the group of 20 and 10 people on the other side, yes, you can be top 10. But if you're with a bigger group, and then you're immediately 20th in the back.
It's quite interesting as well, because I think the play of the week has been pretty much head out left, and we've seen Cameron win the pin there, and he's gunning for that left, whilst Axel Mazzella, he's kind of led this group of port tackers to the right-hand side. And then Maximilian, the leader that we're usually seeing, went for the boat end. So lots of different strategy out there at the moment.
Yeah, we'll see if Cameron gets the chance to do a clear attack and go in front of everybody else. If he manages to do that, I think he's in a really good spot. Let's just hope he doesn't overlay, eh?
So overlaying, doing extra distance that you don't want to do. Well, here we go. We're starting to see the starboard tackers tack over onto port, so maybe they're already close to that ley line.
It's very dangerous also going all the way port, coming up on the top mark with everybody else coming from the right, and you're always, if you're fast enough and you go and you get that 5 meters of space to basically get in and do that fast tack just in front of them and send it downwind, it's really close, and not many people can do it, but let's see if Cameron can make it here happen.
So that's Cameron at the bottom of our picture now. So Cameron Maramanides is going into his tack. This is Tony Vodicek's training partner, but he's going to be behind a few others, and it looks like Cameron's going to be eating the dirt of some of the others that are just tacking in front of him.
And we can see Benoit Gomez, classic Benoit move, going for that port tack start. And he's kind of leading everyone in on that right-hand side. We'll see how it all kind of comes together at the top. Maximilian leading the pack on port there, coming into that top mark. This is going to be an interesting first race.
So that's Max Mader on the far left. A little bit of a splash there for Max Mader. And then the chasing pack just to windward of him, just bottom left of the screen. But already Max Mader with a pretty good advantage on this pack. And now we're going to see if the likes of Benoit Gomez and the others piling in from the right-hand side have a piece of the guys coming in on the port tack ley line.
Yeah, I think Max is already gone. He did an amazing start, got clean air, got free. For Cameron, what I'd say is he was pretty below, not having any reference, so it was really hard for him to stay up. But this is going to be now, who can make it over, who cannot?
It's going to be messy. This is going to be very difficult for the port tackers to find a clear way through. Let's see all potential tangle between third and fourth. Are they going to get away with it? Max Mader is first around, followed by Benoit Gomez. So the best of the left and the best of the right actually did okay. Sam Abbon round in third. Flo Gruber, Teo de Ramacour, Connor Bainbridge, Axel Mazzella.
Oh, one tangle at the back there, but you could see how beautifully everyone managed to kind of slot into place around that windward. As you say, Max just somehow getting nice and clean, just that extra bit of advantage to get around the windward first and everyone else kind of battling behind him. And once he has his lead, he's pretty good at keeping it and extending it. We'll see how it goes for him this race. Going into the jibe there now, everyone else following him.
And Benoit Gomez is second in this race. He's using a fly surfer this week. The Frenchman who has been a proponent of gin kites all by himself for a long, long time, finally given in to fly surfer. And I think we have a clean sweep of the fly surfer brand here today. And Benoit Gomez, a bit of a reluctant convert to the fly surfer, but he seems to be going fast in this race right now and giving Max Maeder a good run for his money at the front of the fleet.
Slowly catching up. They were going really high speeds. Looking at it, basically everybody going the same speed. So it's not about speed anymore. It's just making that better decision, getting the better position, and just being in clear air.
We're also hearing that the water is ventilating. It's a little bit. Lauriane Nolot was telling me yesterday you can't really push hard on the board because you don't know when you're suddenly going to lose grip. So that seems to be a factor.
Yeah, I do believe it is, but at the end of the day, everybody's got the same same problems. Everybody's got the same things. Wow, looking just not on the camera, but looking out on the beach, Max has got a pretty nice lead, and I'm liking it. I'm missing it, being out on the water.
So now's your moment, Tony. There's probably a spare wetsuit. There might be some spare gear. It's not too late.
Tony, if you were out there right now and Max was just ahead of you, what would be your strategy to try and overtake him?
Oh, I'd be calling him. I'd be, Maxi, I'm coming. Nah, it's just stay there, be consistent, try not to make any mistakes and go a little bit faster. I think that's the beauty of the sport. We don't need much wind. We don't need pretty much anything. And the machine in the sport is yourself. So you got to work in yourself. And basically in any sport, the big beauty of it is you got to invest in the sport by investing in yourself.
And I want to mention Sam Aben as well, who's managed to hold on to that third place for a whole leg. And so this is the young Dutch rider who's been up and coming, but we don't often see, well, I don't think I've ever seen him in a top three in Gold Fleet. It's incredibly impressive to see all his winter training paying off there.
And seems to be holding his own very nicely. So nice work from Sam Aben. But still Max Maeder with the red kite on the left-hand side of our screen, being chased by Benoit Gomez with the Dutch Aben in third place. And Conor Bainbridge from Great Britain also in the mix. And Axel Mazzella still coming back from that injury, but seemingly with great confidence. And Mazzella in the French selection trials. There's so many different selection trials going on here, Jimmy. So there's lots of battles within the battle this week as well.
Yeah, you can definitely see that. There's a different vibe. The tensions are high and you can see people are just riding for their lives. It's different out there.
What I'd like to point out there, just looking at the speeds, Max is pretty consistent on the 24 knots, and I can confidently say that's what makes a difference. So anybody's listening, guys, watching later on, come on, boys, get the speed on.
But Tony, the other factor is it looks like Benoit Gomez had pretty good height there as well. A different type of VMG, maybe a little bit slower, but a little bit higher towards the next mark, do you think?
For sure he did, but just not enough speed. And I think the factor getting it in, if you can keep a little bit faster, and even if you're not getting as much height, I think that's the way to go, because that's also more fun, and you're gonna get further on the reach.
So easy to say, they just need to go faster. Tony, you've been working on that all winter. How do you actually do it?
How do you do it? Well,
everyone wants to go faster. Everyone's got the same equipment, more or less. What's the difference?
Well, I'm a bit blunt here, but there's a clear difference from Maximilian and everybody else. And I get the same advantage. We're both on Levitas.
Okay, so a bit of advertising for Levitas, but interesting to see that one of the riders, Daniela Moroz in the women's fleet, is actually trialing Chubanga this week. Normally, the American rider is on Levitas. She's trying the opposite this week. So seems like some are thinking the other way.
There might be, but the results are showing, the results are there, and there's nothing else to look at. I can say firsthand, Levitas is harder to ride, but hey, if that's what is needed, that's what it's needed. We can clearly see that it's working.
So Max Mader on his Levitas foil and on the fly surfer kite, a red kite, I'm very pleased to say. A little bit easier to spot him than some of the others using the standard colours of the fly surfer. Max Mader coming downwind for the final time on this two-lap race. Still being followed by Benoit Gomez, but it's Conor Bainbridge from Great Britain who moves ahead of Sam Abban. So it's Bainbridge from Britain now in the top three. Abban still holding on to fourth with Axel Mazzella from France chasing for fifth.
And it's interesting, Axel's pretty convinced on that right-hand side. He split from the fleet at the leeward mark, and he made some gains there. So I wonder if it's a slightly different day to what we've seen for the rest of the week.
Okay, well, he's certainly, Benoit Gomez, not afraid to tread a different path to everybody else. A little bit of a maverick like you, Tony, I would suggest.
For sure, but got to give credits to Benoit. He's got the balls to go to the other side, and I guess the knowledge that I do not have to understand when it's beneficial to go to the other way. And many times looking at it, has he have the same speed as Max and everybody else, probably even with Bader in front. But really impressive from Connor, I'd say, because in the top, in the first few, four or five places, the positions don't really change. And for him to come after the bottom mark up and manage to take Sam is really good, but nobody's there with Maxi. I'm looking at him now, and he's sad, he's alone, he's crying. You know, we gotta give him some competition.
Yeah, he's looking pretty comfy there. That lead is even bigger than the lap before.
Well, Max Mader, he looks like he's going to square away yet another race win. The Singaporean managed to win all four heats yesterday in Gold Fleet, and it's looking increasingly like he's going to go on to dominate these European Championships. But of course, we have got the medal series tomorrow, which keeps things open until the final day for everyone who makes it into the top 10. So we've got one Gold Fleet race tomorrow, and then after that, we'll see who the top 10 are that will go in to the medal series. But the way things are going, no one's going to be taking that yellow bib away from Max Mader, who is just about to cross the finish line for the first of our four races that we've got on the schedule today.
Yeah, the final format, the last day, the finals are, I think, a really interesting thing. Anything can happen. We've seen people gone from 10th to the podium, and it's really interesting, I'd say, from a viewer's point of view, but really stressful for riders. Congrats, Max, for the race, I have to say. And it's like a completely different sport, short track, completely different approach to everything. So I hope you guys watching are loving it, because it's really stressful for us.
We'll talk about that more in a moment. Let's just give some credit to Conor Bainbridge for moving up another place. Bainbridge, the British rider, up into second. Benoit Gomez falls to third. Axel Mazzella up to fourth. And Sam Abban, who Jimmy called out earlier for such a fantastic race, still finishing a very good fifth place. So good sailing by Sam Abban. We'll go to a quick break. Back to you soon. Okay, we've got 2 minutes to the start of our next race coming up, and that's going to be the women. Jimmy Craythorne, you were part of that strong British squad up until, not that long ago, and the British are going very well, but the French, we have to say, they're in their Olympic selection trial, and they're looking unstoppable this week.
Absolutely. You can really see that those French girls have just pulled it together. They They've always had speed. We've always been incredibly impressed with their speed, but I would say the consistency hasn't always been there, apart from Laurier, who's very good at getting bullets. But to see Jesse and Poema kind of, yeah, bring it all together at this event when it really matters, you can tell the pressure's on, and they're really rising to it. They are showing us what they're made of, and that they are, I think, the three fastest girls in the world.
Tony, last year I would have said that Lauriane Nolot was the obvious pick to go to the Olympic Games for Paris, based on her winning almost everything last year. But certainly the way that Poema Nulin and Jesse Campman are sailing, they're giving the French selectors a little bit of a headache, aren't they?
Well, yeah, for sure. And I think that's the part of it. It's the part of the process for everybody to come there. The Olympics are literally the top of the top, and the fight is on. Like for all of us, fighting different countries, for them is inward. And I think this is also the reason why all of them are actually so good. Now looking 30 seconds to the start, we'll see which one gets there. But I think this is what brought all of them up to those three places, because they're fighting against each other. It's not everybody else. It's like French. First. It doesn't matter. I just need to be in front of everybody else. I mean, in front of the other French. You got to be, yes, but for that, you got to be first.
Well, 10 seconds to go. Let's see who's going to be first off this line. That we know the pin end, the right-hand end of the screen, or bottom of the screen now, is a strong place to start. But it looks really busy at the committee boat end. We see a couple of port tack starters. We'll find out who they are in a moment. But the majority of the fleet, as you would expect, firing off the line on starboard right now.
Some big pressure.
So that was Jesse Campman and Sophia Tomassoni who have gone out right. The rest of the fleet heading out on starboard there.
And Brianna Whitehead looks like she won the pin. So that's the Australian on the furthest left of the shot, and probably the one that we can see furthest left on our shot right now. But also a really good start by Lauriane Nolot, already starting to poke out with very good speed, just a click faster. So Nolo looking strong in these 15 square meter kite conditions. We think there's about 14 or 15 knots of wind, and Nolo is such a powerhouse.
Now, interestingly, Jesse Campman, she's tacked back, so she hasn't gone out all the way right. She's just kind of got out into some clean air and tacked on top of the fleet. Interesting strategy. I think it's a pretty shifty day out there.
Ooh, well, you would hope so, based on what you've just said. I sort of worry about Jesse Campman doing a couple of extra tacks compared with everybody else.
Yeah, but sometimes tacks in the shifty conditions, if you can make them in those 2-3 seconds, they can be a big weapon for you to use in your arsenal.
Well, Tony, you've got to be good at your tacks to justify the maneuver loss, I would have thought. But let's see how that works out for Jesse doing those extra maneuvers. And Leonie Meyer, the German, not able to stay with the group going out to the left. She was one of the ones to tack out early as well.
So in the lead at the moment, we do have a French battle with Lauriane and Poema. Just pretty much match racing there at the top of the fleet. Daniela Moreau's chasing them down as well. Some of the first attack at the top there.
Yeah, it's really dangerous going far on the port, since it's really easy to either overlay or underlay. And it's a hard decision to make. Coming in now, Sophia from port can maybe get there, but we'll see.
So here comes the charge of the French from the left-hand side. Lauriane Nolot in the yellow bib, closely followed by Poema Nulund in the blue bib. And Brianna Whitehead also in the hunt, but Daniela Moroz possibly the closest challenger for the two front runners in the French.
I would just like to give some credit to Elena, the Swiss girl. I think for how long she's been doing it, she's new to the sport and she's doing an amazing job. I think she's definitely one to look out for. And I would almost say I'm rooting for her, not to pick favorites, but she's been doing really impressively, and I really can't wait to see how far she can get.
Well, that very much chimes with what you've been saying this week, Jimmy.
I totally agree, yeah. Yeah, it's impressive. She hasn't just proved herself once or twice. She's done it consistently throughout the week, and she's up there now in fourth place, chasing down some of the fastest, most experienced girls in the world. And she's really holding her own. So our top three there at the moment, we've got Lauriana Lowe, Poema Newland, and Daniela Moroz.
Some girls deciding to go for speed over depth, but we'll see what actually the wind is doing, if the jibe is a long one or not.
So you either go for speed and you go a little bit higher away from your next mark, or you go for a little bit more depth, which tactically gives you more options. Is there a lot of choice, Tony, about different VMGs when you're going downwind?
For sure. Depending on the length of the tack, of what the wind is doing, you should also always be looking at the gusts, the wind coming from above. My coach always says, keep your head out of the boat, which for me is hard. Got many crashes by doing that, but that's the thing. And if you can, just recognize the thing. So yeah, looking here, who's the two coming?
It's
Poema.
That's Poema Newland and... is that Daniela Moroz?
Daniela Moroz and Elena Lengweiler having a good little battle just there.
Doing close to 31 knots, actually. Poema Newland touching 34 knots and looking like she's getting on level terms with Lauriana Nolo. It looks like Poema Newland actually has the legs on Nolo going downwind right now. But also... is that Jessie Campman?
No, so that's Poema Newland. These guys are really trying to chase Lauriana Lowe down. Lauriana's still holding her lead. I think her speed there has actually managed to give her a little bit of extra depth.
We'll see now if Lauriana has space. She has space for a clear jibe. Let's see if she makes a nice rounding or not. That's also a big, big thing. If you can get that little edge to pump up, to be clearer than later on to tack and just keep the speed with it. Whoa, kite going down.
Oh, yeah, crashed just off to the left of our picture, just outside the lower mark. So someone didn't have a good rounding there.
Yeah, but like I said, Lauriana making a clear jibe, but was not in the position to pump it up. Poema's going really high. We'll see if she can stop her from tacking. That's actually a nice thing to do while racing and throw her out of the ley line. Looking at it now, that should be the thing for her to do.
Well, let's see what happens. It's still very close between the French. We've got this battle for Olympic selection between the top three French, Lauriana Nolo, Poema Newland, and Jessie Campman. And that, we think, is our top three in this race right now, with Nolo holding a slender advantage.
Yeah, Poema taking the lead. That's what the tracking's saying. That's a really, really close one. So just who's going to make the better ley line?
So we're seeing different VMGs. We're seeing the speed of Lauriana Nolo, but Poema Newland pointing a little bit higher towards the mark and possibly being able to hold Nolo on and actually control when the two of them tack.
That's really impressive from Poema, going higher and faster, which is really hard to do there. And she's just keeping it consistent, taking the lead on the tracking. We'll see action.
Oh, splash down.
So that's a crash from Poema, and oh, that's sent Lauriana up. She's managed to recover, but she won't be liking that. We'll see if she can hold on to her lead.
Whoa.
Poema, don't listen to us. You got to focus on yourself.
Newland is back up and running again, but oh dear, that mistake is going to cost her dear. These little moments, these are all important moments in that French selection, not least also aiming to win the European title. I think that Newland or Campman really need to win this European title to register in the minds of the Olympic selectors that they deserve to overtake Nolo for Olympic selection. I think it is still Nolo's to lose at the moment, and that was a bit of a slip there.
Another crash from... who was that?
We'll see if we can identify who that crash was in a moment. Daniela Moroz also doing very well. So you think it was Jessie had a bit of a splash down?
Jessie, looking at the tracker, she was going really, really fast. Had she not crashed, she might have even been in position to not let Lauriana tack. It's going to be everything on the last downwind. Looking at it now, Lolo's clear ahead.
There's a lot of ventilation out there. We heard those French girls talking about it yesterday. I think L'Oréal was surprised at how Jessie was still pushing full send, knowing that her foil could ventilate any minute. Whilst I think L'Oréal was holding back a bit more, but she said to us today that there was no holding back. She was going to push everything and just hope that her foil doesn't ventilate. And it seems to be working for her now with a nice lead at the moment.
So it's Nolo in the lead going down the run for the final time, and it's Daniela Moroz from the USA up to second. Ellie Aldridge from Great Britain in third. Katie Dabson and Lily Young also from Great Britain. So it's a 3-4-5 for Great Britain at the moment, and it looks like it's been an expensive run. I'm just wondering if Jessie Campman's also in there as well. Oh yeah, Jessie Campman registering there now on the tracking. So maybe Jessie has actually come back pretty well. But what has happened?
Jessie's
to Poema Newland?
A little bit going out. Poema looking first on the tracking. It's a really hard thing to do. I think you should always be pushing 100%, but once you get in that good position, being on the top three, top five, you should not really risk too much if it's not super important. Just keep it there. Looking at Poema, whom had a bad crash back there, and had he just stayed, been consistent. I know the pressure's getting to the girls, but just stay there. A second place is much better than an eighth or seventh or whichever else.
Lauriane Nolo at the bottom of your screen, wearing the yellow bib, still leading. Daniela Moroz from USA in second, Ellie Aldridge in third. But we also think
Poema's
that Campman...
looking at it there. Poema is on the tracker looking on the 25th. I don't know, something went wrong there, which is very, very close, pushing Daniela. Lolo is far ahead. Lolo, you're doing a Maximilian. Or how the guys described it, and I was reading about it yesterday, Max Verstappen. So, going. Lolo, clear ahead.
So here comes Lauriane Nolo.
We'll see. We don't really... Who's the second?
Let's see. We'll
see. Jessie, no?
I think that's Jessie. Yellow helmet, blue board. Yeah.
With a good comeback. Nice. Good job, Jessie. But don't crash. Come on.
Well, it looks like Lauriane Nolo has taken her first race win of the day. So well done to her. Followed by Jessie Campman. Started pretty unusually. Did those extra tacks up the first beat, but made it work. Crosses the line in second. Daniela Moroz from USA in third. Poema Newland, after challenging for the lead, goes across in fourth. Ellie Aldridge from Great Britain in fifth. And that's Pichetto from Italy in sixth. So a good result for Maggie Pichetto.
Maggie, bye.
So we have our reigning world champions, Max Mader and Lauriane Nolo, taking the first men's and women's fleets, respectively. We will go to a quick break and then back to you very shortly.
So we're back on. We are
3 minutes away from the start of the next men's race. And just to remind you, earlier we had Max Mader winning that race. So the question we all have is anyone actually going to be able to beat the 17-year-old from Singapore in these races? Because he's proving to be pretty unbeatable. Tony, I just want to ask you about the French women. Lauren Nolo, obviously the winner of that race, but some missed opportunities for Kampmann and Newland.
Yeah, for sure. They've been doing really great, really consistent on that race until that little moment. I completely understand how they must feel. It's big pressure on them. It's a lot on the line for the French, especially with this being the qualifier for the Olympic, or I think for them, an important event. But I just like to say to the girls, keep it calm. A second is much better than an eighth or something like that. So without the crashes, Jesse and Poema would have been there fighting for the first.
Yeah, but in the end, Lauren Nolo was the one that made the fewest mistakes. And
for sure.
Is even finishing second in these races going to be enough if Lauren Nolo keeps on winning races?
Well, the last day, the finals can change everything. So it's going to be really interesting to watch and see tomorrow. But it's a nice lead knowing to only have to win one race instead of two races in the last day. And just to be able to be in the finals for being second or either being third, for when you're being third, you're not in the finals, but you're in the semifinals. And knowing that there's also three more girls there fighting for that one spot to be able to go forward, that's a big if, and that's a big challenge. But as I do, I believe that they relish the challenge as well. And I can't wait to see who's gonna smoke Maxi this time. Or hopefully, I don't know, I'm actually really good friends with everybody there on the course, so it's hard to really pick one and choose who to cheer on. But Max has already proven himself, so let's give him a little bit of a challenge and see who can catch him.
Well, Valentin Bontas, he was what I used to call the class clown of the fleet. But since coming fourth in the World Championships in The Hague last year, I was wondering, was that a flash in the pan? Was that a one-off? But he's come back into these Europeans and he's looked really strong here too. Valentin looks like the real deal now.
Yeah, for sure. Val is... I think given everything on the side for it, and we're going to see him now in 30 seconds on the start. Again, a big fleet on starboard. Sanga is still pushing on the port, which is really interesting and I'd almost say scary, because are you going to have space? Looking like they're ducking now.
Well, Dennis Tarradin amongst those, Lorenzo Boschetti from Italy amongst the likely port tack starters, and Sam Abban. Fifth in that last race, and guess who? Which Frenchman do you think? Benoit Gomez, of course.
Benoit Gomez, of course, is there. Four. Let's go. Two. One. Bop.
And there's Max Maeder just to the right of your screen with the yellow bib. Not the best start, but one of the best starts. He's got clear air, and Max got a UFD disqualification earlier this week. No, not now. I shouldn't scare you too much. Well, we need to find out if it was a clear start or not. But no, I'm just saying he already got a UFD this week, and Max was kicking himself for that because he knows that he has the speed to haul himself out of a second row start. And already that red kite of Max Maeder looking pretty strong in the middle of the pack on starboard. What are you seeing, Jimmy?
Well, I have to mention, Jury from Dominican Republic, he's got insane speed. He's just fired off the pin there, and it's created quite a nice little extension with who else has he got there? We've got Teo de Ramacourt and Dor Zarka. They are sending it out left. And again, we've seen quite a big split in the fleet. We've got Benoit Gomez and Sam Abban again leading that pack out right.
Oh, we've just heard, unfortunately, Duri Corniel from Dominican Republic. Great start, but a little bit too good. He got a UFD disqualification. So that's unfortunate for him. He was looking great, but it's not going to be a finish for him.
It's crazy how the guys are pushing to be on the start on time. Really, really close, but very, very slow on the start. Would have been better for everybody to be a little bit more in the back and just send it off of the start line faster, full speed on it. I understand it's really hard to do with a short line with 30 riders there on it. But yeah, Max is being held back from somebody. He's keeping the same speed, but man, looking comfortable already after the tack. And we'll see. Who's the guy just in behind Max? I think that's Valentin. Valentin doing an amazing job here. Let's see. Just depending of the overlay on the mark, but that's looking like a clear stay ahead for Val. Come on, Val, let's go.
Valentin Bontas from Austria really turning on the speed in the last year or so and becoming one of the front runners in this fleet.
He's going to be really happy with this one. He's going to come after the race, he's going to come to the beach and say, Tony, I beat Max with the first top line. No, but they've got a clear advantage already, and that's just because of the start. This is how important the start actually is.
And it looks like these guys that have gone to the left-hand side are going to come ahead of Benoit Gomez and the chasing pack on the starboard side. I think Gomez has the best of the right-hand side, but it doesn't look like it's going to be enough. So, Tony, you didn't really like that approach that they're taking doing the port tack start. It doesn't seem like it's worked.
I do like it, and it can be really good. I just think that it can be very dangerous to go because of the wind shifts, and just when you're going starboard, getting that long one, and if the guys on port can make a really easily misjudge the ley line. So I think that's the dangerous part there.
Yeah, it looks like they're squeezing a little bit on that ley line from the right hand side, but actually the right hand side not looking as bad as I thought. It's actually a pretty even battle here, Jimmy.
Super close. Yeah, we can see Benoit now in second. Max managed to just squeeze in ahead of him, but it was a little bit harder for Valentin, who I think has managed to stay in that third place. But yeah, that pack was pretty strong from the right.
Yeah, a much more even approach to the top mark than I thought. So Benoit Gomez being the closest competitor to Max Mader, but also in there, Denis Taradin also doing well. The Cypriot rider also started on port and went out to the far side.
Benoit's got this amazing ley line judgment, and I think that's why also he is really confident when going to port and just nailing it like he did now. With an attack less, that's already about a 5 second difference, which is really good. But we're gonna see now they're going far off. Some guys making an early jibe. Let's see if that makes a difference. Let's see if they get the shift or not.
Looking really close between the front few, but it is still Max Mader who just holds a marginal advantage. But I wonder if some of the others that jibed earlier have found some better breeze. People like Lorenzo Paschetti, some of the other riders that decided to jibe earlier. It looks like Maxime Nocher also has good breeze by jibing earlier. So will some of the chasing pack at the back of the top 10 be able to get back on level terms?
They looked pretty good and they're looking very fast, just depending of if they get a shift or not.
It could be a traffic jam down at this bottom mark. I think Max made
it. That's what we love to see.
We love to see it from our perspective, Tony. I don't know what it feels like when you're in the thick of that traffic jam.
That's like being in traffic in London on the rush hour.
It's a little bit faster moving. I don't think we get to do 34 knots in the middle of London very often. Here comes Max Mader at the bottom of your screen, just taking a little look around. He's actually managed to stretch his legs a little bit on the rest of the fleet. Red Kite goes up in the air. Max Mader gets through the jibe, back into the power zone, and then approaching the bottom turning mark, and he's going to be in the lead just narrowly ahead of some of the others. Valentin Bontas looking good.
Nice rounding, clear ahead. Val, where is Benito? Where are you, my friend? Hard to see who is who.
It looks like Denis Taradin in that third position. The rider from Cyprus looking pretty strong there. Again, these front three have managed to just extend on the kind of craziness of the rest of the pack. Everyone is so close. We can see a few tangles there. Meanwhile, Maximilian just extending that lead, looking comfy out front there.
Going for an early tack. I wonder why he's deciding to go out the other way. Maybe he liked what Benoit Gomez had.
He's keeping it safe. Half of the fleet made an early tack, so he was almost forced to tack with them. Because had the other guys just gotten another shift, he would have been in the back. So keeping it safe, smart decision, smart move.
Yeah, putting a loose cover on the rest of the fleet that are going out to the right. The closest to him looks like Valentin Bontas from Austria, Denis Taradin from Cyprus next down. And then we got Benoit Gomez and Ricardo Pianozzi a little bit further to leeward.
Yeah, Valentin looking pretty fast there, not keeping so much of a high angle, which is not so good, but if he keeps the speed and makes the correct timing for the attack, he can still win the game. Looking like he's got a clear to attack whenever he wants, just waiting for the ley line.
Max Mader doing close to 24 knots upwind, just standing on a 1.5 meter carbon board. So efficient, these machines. We're on day five of the Formula Kite European Championships in Marmanor in Spain. It's flat water. We're on Europe's biggest saltwater lagoon, so super flat water, but it can be difficult. We've heard that the foils can ventilate, and so it's hard to push as hard as you would want to at times, but it doesn't seem to be causing a problem at the moment.
Let's see now if Val makes the correct timing. It's gonna be close. He gets to get up the speed fast. Just a little bit behind Max. Yeah, I'm thinking he overlaid quite a bit there. That's a disadvantage of going far left.
We call that far right, just to be clear.
Sorry, well, yeah. I'm usually on the water, my foot on the left forward.
All right.
Thinking it the other way, correct.
That Sam Abban looks like he's coming in pretty nicely from the left-hand side of the racetrack. I'm not sure he's going to threaten Max Mader for the lead, but it looks like there are opportunities on the left-hand side of the course.
Definitely. There were two very clear packs. Kind of the fleet can't decide what is going on out there. It's definitely one of the more shifty days that we've seen. As Tony said earlier, it's a day for keeping your head out the board and just keeping an eye out on what is going on. A lot of opportunity to be had, I think, here.
Well, what I'm thinking here now, if I was Valentin, let's just get a nice slingshot around, get inside of Max, not let him tack. But like I said, they overlaid quite a bit. I'm thinking quite both of them, which are pretty confidently above. And we'll see now who gets more speed. I'm thinking it's not so much about getting depth on the downwind. On the start, it's just get speed, and then with speed, you can have anything you want.
Tony, you say kind of Valentin's best move is getting on the inside of Maximilian, but has anyone actually ever managed to achieve that? His roundings are insane.
Yes, it's good. That's what I love about it. You know, the better he is, the better I get. Which, I'm liking what I'm seeing. He's been really consistent, no crashes. And I could say a little bit of luck with I haven't seen many ventilations from him, but luck is a skill as well. And what we're looking at now, it's incredible.
So do you think that when Max Mader is ahead, are we seeing him put his foot to the floor? Is he doing just enough?
Oh, believe me, he likes the attention. He might not show it, but he loves to be that 1 meter more in front. I know it. He's keeping it safe for sure, but still pushing. Because you never know what happens. You can hit a plastic bag, you can get a bad shift, your kite can invert. So always keep the foot down, go fast, but stay safe. Because if you fall, if you crash, if you're those 10 meters more in front, that might just be enough to keep you in the lead.
I agree. I think Maximilian's pushing, but I don't think we've seen 100% from him yet. I think he's always got more to give, more in the tank. And well, these scenes are just incredible. Like for Valentin Bontas to be that far ahead and just kind of really hanging on the coattails of Maximilian, not quite within touching distance at the moment, but both of them just extending this lead on the rest of the fleet is amazing.
What I'm thinking here now is I think all of the riders have it in them to bring this out of them, to do like what Valentin did now. They just got to be there and push and pull with them. Because it's really a much easier job to stay in front once you're there than to get in front when you're still back in the pack, because back in the pack there's people above you, below you, keeping you in the back, giving you bad air, and you always need to fight for it. So I'm thinking, just do your own thing, keep clear, and ride alone. And Max doing this the best. He's always in clear air.
Life's easy in clear air, isn't it? As Max Maeder crosses the finish line for the second time today in the lead. So that's two race wins to Max Maeder. But this time in second place, Austria's Valentin Bontas with a bit of a gap back to third place. There's still a race across the line. Dennis Taradin, Riccardo Pianozzi, and Sam Abban for the second time. Looks like he might take a fifth place if he's not beaten by Axel Mazzella. But Abban from the Netherlands actually having one of the most consistent days.
Yeah, it's amazing. We haven't seen any big tangles today, which on a day like this, a gusty, shifty day with a lot of ventilation, is really hard. This is the top 30 of the world. Well, I'd say top 31. There's another one missing, but well, it's a spectacle to see.
Tony, thank you. Back to you very soon after a quick break.
DR5, built to win.
Okay, so we have got just over 2 minutes until the start of the next women's race. We saw Lauriane Nolot win the previous race, being pushed hard by her French rivals until their crashes. So we saw a splashdown by Poe Manulin when she was pushing to take the lead away from Nolot, and Jessie Catman, despite an unorthodox start to the race, which I wasn't too sure was going to work out, actually did pretty well by the end of the race. And others to watch out for, we've already seen Ellie Aldridge from Great Britain, Elena Langwieler from Switzerland also in there. And Jimmy, we got a number of other trials going on. We got the Italian trials. It looks like Maggie Pichetto is winning those Italian trials. And Gal Zuckerman, well, she came in to the Israeli trials a little bit behind Maya Ashkenazi, but it's Gal who's having the better of the week in Marmanor. So we'll have to see how some of these other trials play out as well.
For sure, yeah, it's not clear-cut at all. I think with each of these nations, we're just seeing a lot of unexpected riders kind of come through to the top. And when the pressure's on, I think it really draws out what the people's potential and what they can give us.
Everybody's giving it their all. That's what we love to see, the battle, the hard-earned training at home. I'm thinking the race is not one here, but it's one at home when you're actually putting all the hours in, not going out for fun, but waking up early, going to the gym, going cycling, going on the water, and I think that's the beauty of it. Well, I'm pretty surprised here we don't have many port starters now. I think there's a few.
We've got Maddie Anderson. Actually, Nolot looks like she's lining up for a port tack start. So.
And Poema as well.
So, bit of a French match race to come off the pin end of the line by the looks of things, unless it's going to be a very, very late tack.
Oh, Maddie's just changed her mind there, I think. Someone just tacked back in towards the fleet.
Well, we have to see, Tony. It might be that everybody ends up tacking onto starboard. Let's see if there are any.
Oh, no, they're going to go. But look, it's 2 seconds, 1 second to the start. All kites are up. Come on, girls. Get them down. Go fast. And we're off.
And they are off. Oh, a bit of a splash. Somebody had a bit of a splash just there, but Poema Newland blasting out to the right-hand side with Lauriane Nolot and Maya Ashkenazi. So our top two in this championship so far, Nolot and Newland deciding to go out to the right-hand side early and break away from the rest of the pack.
Yeah, I think Lauriane is trying to play it safe. That's why she's following Poema, just to do some match racing with it. And this might be a really good thing for them, but like we said, it's really hard to judge the ley line. That's the thing to do. It would be pretty easy for me here looking on the computer. In tack in 3, two, one, beep. That would be pretty interesting to see, but this is a one-man band on the water, and you gotta make a lot of decisions out there, which have to be done really fast. You gotta be looking everywhere, which is really hard, and then trying to anticipate when you might get some ventilation.
We can see Jessie Catman at the bottom of our screen there as well. She just went full in for the pin, and she's got some really good speed going there.
But look at Elena, the Swiss girl, above, having height, having speed. Well, by the way, looks at it, she also has time to tack whenever she wants. I'd say that's the position I'd want to be in right now on this race.
Meanwhile, it was a clear start. Tony, you told them to get a move on at the start time. Everyone was behind the line at the start, so everyone in this race is still in the race.
For sure they're in the race, but that's the thing. You're either there, you're fighting for that half a second, trying to maybe be over, but not the people to see. It's a really tough battle there, and... Yeah, it's hard to say either. It depends also which position you are. You have any disqualification, any drops left or not, for which then you can take. Wow, it's looking Elena being very well off, but the port starters, they're looking pretty well as well. Doesn't look like they're on the ley line, though.
I do wonder if Lauriane Nolo, Poema Newland have under-tacked the ley line. Maybe they don't have the same antenna, the same radar as Benoit Gomez that you were talking about earlier, Tony. It looks like Nolo and Newland might have to do an extra tack because they may not be up on the starboard ley line. So that could be a bit costly. And it looks like the bulk of the pack coming in from the left-hand side might just have the legs on them, and Elena Lengweiler looks like she's the best of the pack coming in from the left.
Looks like it, yes, which is what I said earlier. It's really dangerous to go, even though Elena might look in the back, but the girls have two more tacks to do while she's got only one. But Jessie above, again, looking very confident, very comfortable, because she didn't overlay, she just did it perfectly. Let's just see if she's got a nice rounding. Sometimes it's hard to do a nice rounding when you're so high. They don't let her.
So who's it gonna be getting around? It's gonna be, could it be Maya Ashkenazi?
Maya, whoa!
So the Israeli rider.
A little bit of a too early tack.
Oh, splash down.
So, caught up on the windward there. This is catastrophic. Meanwhile, Maya Ashkenazi just taking advantage of everyone getting all roadblocked up there at the top and extending that lead. Incredible stuff from the Israeli rider.
Right, who will just try and work out who? Look at the yellow mark.
That's Elena. Yeah, that's Elena.
Elena Lengweiler.
Exactly. Wow, come on, man. I was cheering for you there.
So Maya Ashkenazi from Israel leading this race. What an amazing race by her. And she really needs to get some points back on Gal Zuckerman if Ashkenazi is going to win the Israeli selection. So now's her opportunity.
Yeah, she's understood from going upwind from the first leg that on the starboard side, correct? We're talking the same side exactly now. And she's still going there. The other girl's going pretty far, but the starboard side looks like it was the right choice. But then again, are they gonna lay, or do they have to do more tacks, or jibes?
We can see Jessie Campman with some extraordinary downwind speed and incredible depth as well. She's slowly closing in on Maya Ashkenazi.
She already passed her.
She's already passed her,
on
yeah.
The tracking. And looking at the live video, she passed her. Yeah, she's cleared to jibe. I think Maya... Yeah, might be clear, but just depends on the timing of the jibe. Are they going to go enough or are they going to go too much?
So Jessie Catman going a little bit deeper than Maya Ashkenazi, but now is the moment of truth as the French and Israeli riders jibe onto starboard. And have they done enough to stay ahead of the charging pack coming down on the inside of them? People like Lauriane Nolo and Poema Newland, Maddie Anderson. Campman, is she a little bit above ley line? I wonder.
Are they in the zone? Are they clear to jibe? Who was first in the zone? Jessie has clear. She's not clear. That's close. Very close. Very hard to say.
It's going to be very busy around this bottom mark. There's no clear leader right now.
No overlap, both clear to go around. Jesse got a height advantage. Wow, that was impressive. This little push just here can be so important for the end, because Lorien again, just a little under. Or no, Poema was above. Sorry, guys.
So we think it's Poema Newland that got the slightly better rounding compared with Jesse Campman, but Jesse just managing to hold on to the lead and in the slightly better position.
Jesse's got the foot down, her speed, some crashes in the back, small splashes.
So it's three French in the top three right now, and it's Jesse Campman, the best of those French, ahead of Poema Newland and Lorien Nolo, and our former race leader Maya Ashkenazi, now in fourth place.
Yeah, we'll see. Lorien is playing lottery again. She's going to the other side. It's really stressful on the waters, but now for Jesse and Poema going that side, not knowing where Lorien is, she might get it, she might not, but we'll see.
Poema is pushing Jesse hard. We can see Jesse's height just rising up and up, and Poema falling a little bit back into her dirty wind. These guys will not be wanting to make any mistakes. I think they'll be frustrated with the last race. Anyone could have won that one. Jesse is hungry for the win. You can see her just turning back, seeing if she can make the tack past Poema.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Jesse looks pretty confident, but is she clear to tack? That's the question. It's hard to say from what we're seeing now. Poema may lead her out very far out of the ley line, which would be, I think, the play for her now.
Yeah, Poema will be making it hard for her, I can imagine. Jesse just has to keep on going, trying to grab as much height as she can so she can make that tack clear ahead.
And while they're having their French match race on the left-hand side of the race course, what we're looking at here, meanwhile, Lorien Nolo sailing in clear air on the right-hand side, but what's her ley line judgment going to be like?
Yeah, Jesse, Poema's not giving in. She's taking Jesse so far out, which is a right thing for a double or nothing. But
for a match race, yes.
For a match race, for sure, but like what we talked about a bit earlier, can Lorien get to the top mark? Did she make the right decision? Earlier, the guys did not make it around.
So it's so crazy. A battle for first place has turned into more like a battle for fourth and fifth now, as Lorien is looking strong on that right-hand side. It can change so fast if you just get caught up in the moment.
So we'll have to see if that was red mist that got in the way. Did Poema Newland get a little bit too caught up in her personal battle with Jesse Campman, or are they still going to kind of come in ahead? It looks like they might still have done enough to come in from above the left-hand A line and still be able to be leading around this top mark.
This is going to be hard. I was in this position before. Are they going to be overlaid? Is there going to be a protest for coming for who has a clear of way? It's hard to say who is who. On the GPS, they look very, very close.
And it looks very close on the video as well. It looks like Lorien Nolo, could Nolo get back in front of the other two? It depends.
They're just stacking. Three of them managed to get around. Oh, Lolo, get them. Wow, that was amazing. That early tack. Poema was trying. She's just in front of Jesse now, but they just gave enough room for Lolo to go through and take the lead here. We got still a long downwind to go, but let's see now. We saw earlier that going far fourth, or for them starboard, but for us left, it was the better chance to do. Let's see who can jibe clearly ahead. I think they might be pushing each other out again and maybe giving some room for somebody else, but we'll have to see. Lolo's tracker slowed down. She's in the back. Did she crash?
We don't know. I don't think so. I think that's Nolo at the bottom of our screen now. So Nolo in the lead. Still looking like she's going to win another race right now. And well, we can do a bit of a post-mortem on this race afterwards, but if Nolo ends up winning this race by a whisker from Poema Newland and Jesse Campman, we have to ask whether that match race out on the left-hand side of that windward leg was really worth it.
I think it was for Poema, but she took it just a little bit too far, which is always so hard to say if it's enough or not enough, because many times I was in Poema's position and I was thinking, all right, I pushed him enough, but then it was like the wind shift or the wind change, which you can't really know, and it's hard to say, hard to tell if you're there or not. But now clearly it did not play out like Poema wanted. Well, 50-50. Got in front of one, forgot about the other one.
And this is the one they forgot about. It's Lauriane Nolo who completes her final jibe, getting down to mark three at the bottom of the course. And then it will be the slingshot into the finish. So it looks increasingly like the reigning world champion is going to be taking another race win today. And that's going to stretch the lead for Lauriane Nolo if she can just keep it together for this final reach across the finish.
Like I said earlier, luck is a part of the sport, and it's not luck, it's skill. So that was for sure a little bit of luck for Lauriane, but she deserves it.
She went her own way up that last leg. I mean,
that was like I said earlier, that was lottery, and it paid off. She hit seven red. Or black, or whichever one. I don't play.
So just behind her, it was Poema Newland that just beat Jesse Campman across the line in the battle between those two French, with Katie Dabson up to fourth place. And looks like Gal Zuckerman, the Israeli, overtook Meir Ashkenazi, who, if you remember, had been leading in the early stages of that race. So just when Ashkenazi had an opportunity to pull some points back on Zuckerman in the Israeli trials, it looks like Zuckerman has actually got the better of the battle between the two Israelis. So quick break, back to you soon.
Meet the R1 V4, our highest performance Olympic and IKEA registered racing machine.
Three minutes to the start of our next race, more like coming up to 2:30 actually. So this is going to be our third men's race of the afternoon. We're going to be bringing you four for the men and four for the women. This is day five of the Formula Kite European Championships here in Marmanor, Spain. It's a little bit of an overcast day. We've had some lovely sunny days earlier in the week, but Jimmy, we certainly can't complain about the wind. The wind has been on all week, hasn't it?
Absolutely. This has been an amazing event for getting racers away. And yeah, they've had really, really good racing. They've used all of their kite sizes. So we're really seeing who is on top in all conditions. It's good.
And now, Jimmy, what do you think the chatter was between the French in that last race? Because I remember, just tell us the chatter going on between Conor Bainbridge and Martin Dolenz yesterday. There was a great story yesterday. Just talk us through what happened there.
So, similar situation. Connor and Martin were kind of locked in their own little battle, I think, for third and fourth. And then suddenly Connor kind of looked up and was like, hang on a minute, like Maximilian and Valentin have dropped pace a little bit. Maybe there's an opportunity for these guys both to get a 1-2. And so he says to Martin, he's like, come on, Martin, we can get them. So they go from their high mode battle, lock into a low mode, and manage to overtake Valentin. And at the end of the race, Martin was just like, blew Connor a kiss and was like, thank you, Connor. And so I think that was quite a lovely example of kind of looking up and out and realizing that you can work together to climb a few places rather than kind of screw both of yourselves over getting locked in your own battle, which you kind of saw a bit with Poema and Jesse, which I'm sure there'll be a few spicy words said on the coach boat now, but you can see that they're really fighting. I've never seen them like this, and to have the 1-2-3 French so strong over the line, it's incredible stuff to see.
It does seem like Campman and Newland lost sight of the bigger picture, which is they both need to be beating Nolo. But maybe if we've got time, we'll come back to that later. We've got 25 seconds to the next start. Now, Tony, getting your lefts and rights the same way as we see them, are you going to choose going left or right up the next leg of this race?
I can't really say for sure. I don't really know what the wind is doing out there, but looking at how many guys are going left, it's going to be interesting to see. At this moment, you could go either way. There's enough people on both sides.
Well, it looks like Alex Allen, your training partner, Cameron Maramanides, are among those lining up for a port tack start. But here we see the starboard tackers. And I'm just trying to work out who that is. Jimmy, you're always very good at telling me who's who on these ones. Any clues?
It looks like Dennis Tarradin on the bottom of our screen there. Maximilian Zakowski as well, going for the pin, looking really strong. We've seen him right up there in Gold Fleet. The Polish rider has definitely got the speed at the moment. And there's Marcus Edegren from the USA as well.
And Bruno Lobo amongst them as well. Bruno Lobo from Brazil has been lying in fifth this week and absolutely lapping up these flat water, gusty conditions here on Marmanor. But as you said, Tony, we've got a lot of people lining up for the port approach. There's a lot already.
Maybe even more than half of the guys. And it's going to be scary to see what the wind does, because it basically determines which fleet are you in, either you're in the front or in the back. That's why I'm always, you could almost say, a little bit scared of going port when there's only a few guys going there, because you don't really have much of a reference. But now I think for the guys who didn't know before, they definitely had a good chance and they took it. And we'll see it now. They're looking pretty good on the tracking, but...
Well, Max Mader, meanwhile, sticking to what he knows best, which is starting on starboard and plowing out towards the left-hand side.
And I love that. I do the same thing. I know how to do it, and you just do that. Don't make mistakes. Even though looking here, Max looks third or second, Axel has a tough tack to understand not to be over or early, which I think is a really, really hard decision. I can't point this out enough for how hard it is to make that tack correct time.
So here's our pack of port tackers, and of course Benoit Gomez has to be in among them. Cameron Maramanides also doing very well. Lorenzo Boschetti, the Italian, he's on the back foot in his Italian trials against Riccardo Piannozzi. We haven't said much about Piannozzi today, so Piannozzi not up there as much as he has been. And remember, it's Piannozzi who's the defending European champion from Portsmouth, UK, last September. But Piannozzi hasn't featured as much.
Sorry. I'm sorry to come in here. My camera's doing pretty good there in front. Or is he? Or is he not? Yeah, it's still changing a lot. Just a little bit on the tracking, hard to say. We'll see if the port guys, well now starboard guys, can make it over, or did they overlay, underlay? It's a really hard battle.
It could be a messy convergence here, but it does look like the right-hand side have marginally got the better of it. Very difficult to tell at this stage, but I think that Benoit Gomez and Axel Mazzella, the two French, are slightly further up the ladder rung, so it's going to be up to the likes of Max Mader and Bruno Lobo and Max Zukowski to see if they can manage to sneak through on the port hand lay line.
But that's just so dangerous coming in on the side that you do not have priority over. And it's good to go starboard to the left side of the course on the start for sure. But just to keep going all the way, it's really dangerous. We'll see now. Hopefully no collisions for the guys, no damaged equipment, but it's going to be tight.
So here's the moment of truth. Will the port tackers be able to get cleanly through and manage to get a tack in?
Well, Max is not really impressing us again. It's just same old, same old. But the other guys, they've come through really cleanly, respectable on the race to give space to the ones who are the right of way boats, and now full on to the downwind.
So Max Mader around in first, amazingly. Axel Mazzella, he was one of the ones that went out to the far side in second. Valentin Bontis in third. Benoit Gomez in fourth. So pretty even, but mostly I think that's paid for the port tack starters who went out to the right, apart from Max Mader in the lead.
I would completely agree. I think it was quite a strong move for this race. I think Maximilian's got the speed to kind of make anything work, if I'm honest. And yeah, pretty even both sides. We can see Maximilian still in the lead. Meanwhile, Axel Mazzella and Valentin Bontis having a great battle for second place there.
It's never a great battle when it's a battle for second, but it's a battle that's great. Axel has not been so far in front today. I don't know what's been going on, but he's fighting there. Since they have the guys already jibed just now. Who's in front from the bottom? Yeah, that's Axel clear ahead of Valentin. Let's see, Valentin is going for the speed. He loves the speed like I do. And I think they're focusing too much on each other, not looking at Max, and they're just going fast, but not enough depth. Yeah, that's a really dangerous position for Axel to be in, because look, Valentin has just overtaken him, and now he's giving him better. It's a really difficult position to be in for not having the right of way for jibing, but Axel is just slowly losing. And this just depends how long the leg they have got, how much more they need to go before the jibe.
So coming down towards the bottom of the course, it's Max Mader, the reigning world champion, in the lead. He's not the current European champion. He was absent from last year. He was looking to win the gold at the Asian Games on the other side of the world, which he managed to do. But it's looking like Max Mader is on course to win back that European title. He last won in Greece 2 years ago, if he manages to keep things up. He's just about to go round the bottom of the gate and go up the windward leg for the second time. Max Mader in the lead. Axel Mazzella, the French, just ahead of Valentin Bontis. And Conor Bainbridge and Benoit Gomez also in the mix.
Some guys already attacking immediately after, trying to get the other side, hoping for something better. It's really hard to see now. Whoa! Some crashes on the bottom mark. But Max doesn't know that.
How much can you actually afford to look around?
But that's the thing, you have to, but you can't. You know, look, he just looked back and he's like, did I do it? Did not. And I really like the confidence from him not having the camera on. He's like, I'm just not going to be in between anybody, you know?
Well, he's going out to his favorite left-hand side. He's keeping things simple.
Yeah, he's looking back way too much, I'm thinking, you know, because everybody was attacking earlier, so, but I think he's clear ahead. It looks like the other side is a bit favored with more wind being there, but not many people going there.
Axel Mazzella plowing a lonely furrow out on the right-hand side, so we'll see if the Frenchman manages to do anything special going out to the right. He's in nice clear air. And Benoit Gomez, he does tack now, but actually for once we see Gomez going out to the left, and finally he's breaking out to the right hand side. But Max Mader still not being tempted to cover anybody. Max seems to want to continue to go into the left hand corner.
Yeah, I really like how he's not going all the way but tacking there just to give himself some room had he gone overlay. So just playing it smart, which is good. Not go always all the way to the mark, like on the first leg, because then it's really dangerous. But yeah, I don't know why we're talking about him. He's alone. It's not much to do. Just keep on the speed, Max, and that's it. Axel's tracking. Ah, now it's working again. Yeah, let's see. Yeah, if Axel gets a good tack and a good shift, he might be coming in front of Val, even maybe in front of Max. But that's really hard to say for when the tech needs to be done. It's so hard to judge it.
It looks like Max Mader has a click more speed than Axel Mazzella going upwind. Max Mader.
Axel just came out of attack, so maybe that's why. But Valentin is going smoking in almost 26 knots. Not anymore, but still very fast.
It does look like Bontis from Austria is a little bit quicker than Mader, but Mader going for a higher mode at the moment.
Exactly, which sure might be the way for him, because if there comes a big shift picking the guys up, Max can be in trouble.
We're talking about limited amounts of trouble, really, aren't we? I mean, Mader's got this fairly well squared away, but Bontis does have the speed advantage, as you just pointed out, Tony. And meanwhile, Axel Mazzella in the middle of our screen towards the top of picture.
Just a little bit too far out. Well, we don't really see the top mark yet, but looking just a little bit too low.
It's going to be close. It looks like these top three have really got a bit of a gap on the rest now. So Maida still in the lead. Bontas tacking just ahead of Axel Mazzella. So things haven't changed that much, actually. So Mazzella's breakout to the right, it was a risk worth taking, but it hasn't really changed things that much.
Yeah, I'd have to say I've seen the difference in this rain than the previous ones. What Val did really well was keep close to Max on the start, just stay with him, follow him when he tacks, and he's there. So guys, Max knows what he's doing. I think you've got to notice. Just follow him, be around him, and yeah, make him have some fun. Come on.
What do you learn about different riding styles? The shape of the body shape and the amount of heel and things like that. What differences do you see?
Well, I think every person is a little bit different. There is a little bit optimal for everybody. Got to be a little bit back, but not too much, because if you're not stable enough, it's really hard to push so much. And just get in a position where you're comfortable and just stay in it and don't move. The biggest difference from Max and everybody else is Max is not moving. He's chilling.
Easier said than done, I'm sure. But yeah, he chills his way through that jibe.
And also the jibes, they're done much nicer. The amount he gained from that last jibe was way more than he gained than the rest. And thinking his jibes are beautiful, they should be like on a wall or somewhere, like in a picture.
What makes a good jibe? Why is his jibe so much better?
No idea. You know, this is just something you know how to do. How do you sleep well? Well, on the cold side of the pillow. You don't know exactly how you get the cold pillow, but when it's there, you know how to do it.
Well, Max Maida is certainly sleeping on the cold side of his pillow at the moment. The speed that he's going downwind, he looks very comfortable in these conditions. Bruno Lobo also, he's got come in from the far side of the course. Bruno Lobo fighting up amongst the front few as well. But coming down towards the bottom for the final time, it's going to be Max Maida with Valentin Bontas staying ahead of Axel Mazzella. Conor Bainbridge in fourth, Dennis Taradin in fifth, Benoit Gomez in sixth. Here comes the red kite.
Beautiful jibe. Oh, come on, Fly Surfer, we need more colors. It's hard to tell who's who. We're having a struggle here.
Hallelujah, Tony. That's exactly what I want to hear. Time for some more colors on the race course. But at least we have the red kite of Max Maida that stands out, and it's going to be the third race win of the afternoon with the 17-year-old from Singapore getting yet another bullet. Bontas comes across in second for Austria. Francis Axel Mazzella in third. In fourth, Conor Bainbridge from Great Britain. And then it's close between Benoit Gomez and Dennis Taradin for sixth place. And now they're absolutely piling across the finish line.
Yeah, it's looking like it's hectic out there. It looks pretty windy and flat. I'd say these are one of my favorite conditions. Almost like 15-meter flat. Just go fast, you know?
Well, Tony, we're very happy that you're here instead. Thanks for joining me and Jimmy today. We'll take a quick break. Back to you shortly. Okay. So we got 1:45 to the start of the next race, and this is going to be the third race of the afternoon with the women. And Jessie Campman has moved up to second overall behind Laurie Nolo. So it's still France in the top three, but now the order is Nolo, Campman, and then Poema Newland in third. And Jimmy, I can't help thinking of that match race that we saw, that Newland and Kampen got caught up with each other, and maybe, I don't know if we're being unfair, but maybe lost sight of the bigger picture that they both need to beat Laurie and Nello.
We'll see what happens in this race, if we'll see more from them match racing together, or if they'll give each other a bit more space. I doubt they'll give each other space. No. They can all win races. We've seen that, and they'll all be wanting to win this one. So I think hopefully we'll see the best of them.
Well, we got 50 seconds to the start of the next race. We've seen the port tack starting becoming increasingly popular in the men's race. And so we'll see if there's more of a trend for that. But it looks like most of the women are lining up for a more traditional starboard tack. 30 seconds to go. Lauriane Nolo, the winner of both races so far today. Will anyone be able to take a race off the reigning world champion from France? Up coming as their next opportunity. We got 15 seconds to go. Coming into the final 10, still some way back.
Let's see some
kite start.
Earlier this time, some fast tags. They're all getting very, very close to the line, but still not going. And it's still very, very late. Just the kites coming down even after the start, you could almost say.
Well,
I think for the girls, the girl that's gonna understand what I'm saying just now a little bit earlier than everybody else will have such a big advantage. I know it's hard to know where the ley lines are. Sorry, guys, I was a little bit running. It's pretty windy out there. I think the wind has even picked up a bit, so 15s might even be big for the girls, but they're doing an amazing job.
Good starts for Lauriane Nolo and Pai Manulun going out to the left, the vast majority going out to the left. But Maya Ashkenazi, who was leading in the early stages of the previous race by going out to the right-hand side, well, she's done the same thing again. So the Israeli Ashkenazi looking to see if she can repeat what she managed to do in the previous race, and maybe she'll be able to hold on and keep a good position somewhere near the top of the race course.
Andy, Jamie, wouldn't you guys say it's an amazing place here to be able to see all the buildings in the back just behind the riders, just to appreciate how fast they're actually going. This is upwind, guys. This is a person on a kite, on a foil, pushing 30 knots, well, maybe 25 now, but even later on, even faster. It looks not so fast when you're looking just the water, but when you're seeing building in the backs, it's an amazing thing. And wow, with that crash, when you crash, I can say firsthand, that's not water.
It's gotta hurt.
It's gotta hurt, definitely. Yeah, the girls are tacking. Let's see, clear tack around.
That's Lauriane Nolo.
Not in the best position, somebody is above.
I think maybe that's Poema Newland just tacking now on the left of our screen. So Poema at the moment has a small advantage on her French rival for selection.
Now we'll see now Poema, Lauriane both looking like they're second and third. But Will, did they make the right call tacking? What I'm thinking is Poema may have gone a little bit too far. I know it's a safe move to do, to look at Lauriane there, but hard to say, but Lauriane is clear to tack whenever she wants.
And Lauriane Nolo looks like she has a slightly higher angle upwind compared with Newland. Maybe Nolo giving up a little bit of speed to get a bit of tactical advantage, trying to close the gap on Newland.
Ah, it's an amazing battle. She's going really, really high. Poema's going down low. Tracker stopped working, so I don't know.
I don't think there are so many starboard tackers for them to worry about. It looks like the left-hand side of the race course, the riders that we're looking at now are going to come out ahead at the top mark. So
yeah, I'd just like to point out Jessie here. She's going fast, but damn, she overlaid so much. It's really, really hard there, and for her, and now she's spitting in. We see now Poema looking like she's first, but I don't see, Lauriane.
No, I'm not sure if the track is working properly for Lauriane, but let's see.
Jamie, you know all the riders just by seeing them. Look, the kites are the same. You know exactly who's who.
Have we lost Lauriane Nolo?
I think that's Lauriane Nolo around the windward first. You can see her gold bib there. And then we've got, Poema Newland chasing her down in second place. And that looks like Britain's Ellie Aldridge in third position there at the moment.
And pretty good for Maya Ashkenazi going around at about fifth or sixth. So the port tack start has worked out pretty well for the Israeli. So again, she finds herself in front of Gal Zuckerman, her rival for Israeli selection. So that seems to be a tactic working quite well for Ashkenazi.
Not many people making an early jibe. I guess this means a lot, but Jessie just overlaid a lot. She's still in seventh. It's not so bad for how she made it. Somebody made an early tag. The China's going the other way.
So here's the simultaneous jibe from the two French riders. Nolo holding the narrow advantage from Poema-Newlin in the front. And we're now a little bit further back. That's Nolo on the left, actually, I think. From a different perspective.
On the right-hand side, still in the lead. Then we've got Poema-Newlin just behind her. Another 1-2 French race here with Ellie Aldridge just behind them for Great Britain. We can see, Ellie just above them on the screen there.
So Nolo, bottom middle of the picture with the yellow bib, still being pushed hard by Poema-Newlin, getting down to the bottom of the course.
Oh, must be crazy. Such a small country with so many good riders. Well, a massive country with the most good riders, top three at the moment. Why am I jibing? Let's see if they're gonna be clear. Both clear. Where's the boy? Still got a bit to go. Just this bottom round mark. Sorry guys, bottom mark rounding so important, which Poemas has been doing just a little bit better. Whoa, a little crash there. And doesn't look so good. Not the best, but still looks higher.
Nolo leading Newland and a bit of a gap back to the next. And that's Ellie Aldridge from Great Britain in third and Switzerland Elena Lengvila and Daniela Moroz not far behind.
They've made a nice gap. Ellie has gotten a really nice high groove there at the beginning. Let's see if she can keep it up and maybe get some speed to just be in front and not allow the guys to tack. That's the really important part there, not allowing the rest to tack.
It's a bit of a messy rounding for a few in the middle there, kites in the water. So that's the problem with being caught in the traffic jam. And we'll try and identify who that is. But is that kite going to get back up in the air? We'll have to wait and see.
We have Julia in the water, Maya as well. Polish attacking. Or I don't know who did it, who started or what happened. Doesn't look so good for the kites.
So you do not be, you don't want to be getting your kite wet if you can possibly avoid it. But it's happened to somebody. We'll try and identify who that is for sure.
Lorien looking good in front, able to tack.
Jessie Campman going out to the right-hand side. So France protecting both sides of the race course. Campman looking to see what she can get back on the other two French who are out on the left still in their match race.
Well, let's see now if Poema can get the high groove again. Ellie's pushing up really high. She might even overtake her there. We're looking, they've gotten a little bit of a shift. They've all been taken quite up a bit. That doesn't mean the best for Jessie, but looking still good.
Lorien Nolo leading from the left-hand side of the race course. Still being chased by Poema-Newlin. Daniela Moroz and Ellie Aldridge amongst the front few. And Jessie Campman out on the far side. We can't see Jessie in this shot at the moment, but Jessie getting up to the starboard ley line on the far side. I'm not sure if she's far enough forward to be able to provide a threat to Lorien Nolo. That's Nolo in the middle of screen with the yellow bib. And just to windward of her, I think that's the kite of Daniela Moroz that we're seeing. But
Jessie
some way back.
Starboard, it's gonna be close. It's gonna be interesting to see who makes it over. If she's on the ley line, on the computer, it looks a little under, but you never know, it's never exact. On the screen looks a little in the back.
That's Jessie, bottom of picture.
It's gonna be really interesting with Ellie and Poema.
Ellie.
Looks like Ellie's climbed up on Poema. I think Poema's gone for the lower undertake. Both attacking now. Ellie just below her. And then Poema on top there.
I think Ellie just pushed Poema to tack too early. That's such a strong position to be in. And now, I don't know if she's even going to make it. Come on, Poema, push up. Lorien comfortably in front, going around, beautiful slingshot, and just bye-bye, boys.
Well, bye-bye, girls.
Bye-bye, girls, exactly.
Oh, Ellie having to tag again. Oh, no.
It's the other way around.
Oh. Ellie drops her tag there, just underneath that windward mark, so Poema can just get away free there. Ellie back in fifth now.
And Jesse Cameron in third.
This
is what I was saying earlier. Just important, just to be clear, just to be safe, and just keep that position. A second, a third, that's an amazing, much better than a sixth, fifth, or whichever in the back. The girls are making a long snake. It's not super close anymore here. Hard to say what happened. Well, the bottom mark happened for most of them.
Nolo has certainly extended, so that's Nolo successfully completes her jibe, now on port jibe, still being chased by Poema Newland and Jesse Campman. So it's France 1-2-3 again.
Really impressive from the French. They've developed some of the best riders in the world. Well, for sure the best girls in the world. Men, definitely over the years, they've been on top for many years. Sorry, guys, me and Max happened in the between. But after that, they're still amazing. And Lorien in front, keeping a clear and safe distance, doing a max mater over here.
Nolo only doing just under 30 knots. We know that she can go faster than that. Do you think?
Definitely keeping it safe. Keeping it safe. She's not really going so deep as well, but I think from her point of view is if she doesn't go way too much out of ley line, she's clear. Because from the camera, Jessie looks pretty dangerously deep there. And if, she's jibing, that looks good. We'll see now if Jessie can jibe earlier. I don't exactly know where the bottom buoy is, but
well, I think
incredible
it's...
Incredible gains from Jessie, though, climbing through the fleet, battling Poema for that second place. Well, Lorien still looking really comfy coming into this final reach. So that is Poema coming around the mark there. Sorry, Lorien coming around the mark there for the final reach.
Here comes the yellow bib of Lorien Nolo. It's going to be a third race win today and further extend her lead on the overall standing. So congratulations to Nolo, being chased by her two French teammates, the rivals for Olympic selection. It's going to be Poema Newland and Jesse Campman coming across in second and third, and Ellie Aldridge to come across in fourth. Despite that splashdown at the top mark, Aldridge holds on for fourth ahead of USA's Daniel Moroz and then GBR's Maddie Anderson. And Jingle Chen from China. We've not said so much about Jingle Chen today, but Jingle up in the top seven or eight in this race as well.
And my Maggie coming just behind. Pretty good.
Maggie Pichetto from Italy also doing well and continuing to stretch her lead in the Italian trials. And Maya Ashkenazi, I think maybe just about managed to stay in the top 10. We will have a quick break, come back to you shortly.
Okay, so this is the men now lining up for race 8 of the Gold Fleet.
We're alone, we're holding the fort now, while Ent is gone. Awesome. I think he has gone to show the guys how it's done, picking up the kite, getting my gear, he stole it, but that's why we're changing jobs now. And yeah, 2 minutes to go. It's going to be interesting to see. This is the last race for the boys today. Is it or is it not? Am I correct?
Yes. Yes, this is the fourth race.
2 minutes. What I want to see from this one is clean racing, sportsmanship behavior, and as many tangles as possible.
Tony, if this was you lining up right now, what would your strategy be?
My strategy would be get clean. Whoever thinks they know me, escape from them, because there's definitely many people always following behind, trying just to be there, and then in the last moment just mess you up a bit. But I'd say try to find that gate, that opening on the start line, and get it and take it. And it is what it is. At the end, you can't look back.
1:15 to the start of the race, and we saw a strong trend towards a port tack start in the previous men's race. So let's see how much of a vote there is for that this time round. Tony, what are you thinking?
I'm not pretty sure. We saw Derry going OCS one race, which I have to say, I really like that, because that means he's pushing the limits, he's really taking it, and I want to see almost more people getting some OCSs. That means everybody's pushing, because looking here, it looks like many people are either a little late on the start or just not taking it with full speed. So, yeah, but for my tactic, it would be the same. Go starboard on the left side of the course and do what I know how to do. Don't learn anything new.
20 seconds to the start.
A lot of people coming port, more on starboard, so port is now a dangerous way. Max coming from the back, can he get clearly through for 7 seconds? 5, 4, 3, 2, still slow, guys, go! Bob, looking better than the girls for sure. Coaches, keep notes. We'll see how they went.
And it's quite an even split, isn't it, between port and starboard. We got quite a few going for the port tack start underneath the pack, but of course Max Mader, we never see him veer away from the conventional starboard tack start. That's him on the right hand side of the screen, just gone out of shot.
And I've noticed in every race Valentin is not too far from Maximilian. He's keeping him close from the beginning and just following him around the course, and yeah, it seems to be working for him. Let's see how it works this race.
For sure, Max knows where to go, and if you just follow him, that's a big advantage already. There's not so much space for everybody to be there, but if you're there, if you're listening, follow him. Don't follow me when I'm there. So exactly.
Ricardo Pianosi and Lorenzo Bischetti going out on the far side. We can't see them so much. They're in the top right in the distance, but there's a bit of an Italian match race going out on the far side. But the orangey red kite of Max Mader looking pretty good on the left-hand side.
And how we see it already here, Max is in a beautiful position, clear ahead, has free air, has free space under him, and that's just where you want to be, guys. Everybody's pushing, trying to do too much match racing. Well, what you should just be doing is going alone and having free, clear air.
I think, speaking of match racing, I think we'll be seeing something between Maximilian Sikorski and Maxim Nocher as well. They're both fighting for the final position in the medal series. It's only the top 10 that will go through. So we'll see. They're on joint points at the moment. It's all to play for.
Yes, that is a very good point. We of course, do have that battle, as you've just pointed out. It's super close. And what we love about our format is that anyone in the top 10, as long as you get into the top 10 on the final day, then you have an opportunity still to win overall, because in a conventional normal sailboat racing series, Max Mader probably would have already wrapped up this championship. But Max hasn't got anything in the bag yet because of that medal series.
Exactly. That has been a big, big shot for everybody. And it's just made everything harder. But what I think, if we can be fun and we can be interesting for the people to watch, that's the way to go. Doesn't matter if it's hard for us. We're the best in the world and we can do anything. And we can make it interesting even better.
Valentin Bontz is actually up to second overall in the standings. Riccardo Pianozzi seems like he's been pretty quiet, but he's actually in third. But yeah, Bontas having another amazing championship here.
Yeah, I think Riccardo had such a solid qualifying. I think that's really kind of worked for him, keeping him in the top three all the way through this week. But as you say, we haven't seen him in the top three too much in Gold Fleet.
No, but proving to be very consistent. And Pianozzi, one of the best coming in from the starboard side. That's the group that we were looking at just then. But it looks like Max Mader, as usual, is going to come in just ahead of the dangerous pack coming in on starboard with rights. These are the boards that come in with rights. But there's Max Mader with the yellow bib just tacking now. There up goes the orange kite in the sky.
Well, this is a really dangerous position for everybody else to be following Max. If you guys come there, there's not so much space. You gotta have that little bit of leverage, little bit of room just to be in front, to be able to go around. Bruno in third, Max Zakowski in second, and another black GPS, Jan. Wow.
So Maximilian Zakowski, he really wants to be in that top 10, and he is showing us that he is worthy of it.
We still have one more Gold Fleet race tomorrow before we have the medal series. So this is not the decider right now that we're watching. But of course, every point counts. And
everything can still happen. Max Zakowski, even in this race, can hit a plastic bag, which hopefully he doesn't. But never, never rule it out. Anything can happen, guys. Even for everybody, for the girls who are fighting for the Olympic spot, you can get injured.
This is Connor Bainbridge we're looking at here, and this is an important regatta for Connor to reestablish his confidence. Great Britain not yet got a spot at the Olympic Games, and the last chance regatta in the south of France, that's the critical moment for Connor Bainbridge to claim one of those remaining places. Must be a relief to you, Tony, that you got that done at The Hague last year.
Oh, it's a relief. It doesn't really matter, because we gotta push, and yeah. But looking at Connor, I definitely see him taking one of those spots. We got Max Zakowski taking the other one.
Well, I don't know about that. We've got Jan, Max's teammate, also up there in fourth at the moment. I think both of these guys are neck and neck for Poland. Their level is super similar.
Well, let's rephrase it. I'm thinking Poland being there, Great Britain being there. So, yeah. Jamie, you're still getting there. And who do you guys think are the other ones? What are your thoughts?
Yeah. Well, we've got a lot of those contenders in the Gold Fleet competing right now. We mentioned Dury Corniel from Dominican Republic.
We've got Wojciechowska, who's in fifth at the moment for Czech Republic. Sam Aben for the Netherlands.
Sammy.
Cameron Maramanidis for Greece as well.
Just a bit of a splashy rounding for Max Mader there, but he is safely round, followed by Max Zakowski from Poland.
Max was just cleaning his booty a little bit.
That's what it was.
An amazing job, Max, today. It was a pleasure watching you. Hopefully you get to give us an amazing performance tomorrow, because you're a performer giving us an amazing show, and it's just nice to watch, maybe even a little bit boring.
Well, it's a good race to be called Max right now. We've got Max Mader followed by Max Zakowski, and then Brazil's Bruno Lobo in third, and then another Polish rider, Jan Marciniak. So this is a really good race for Poland between these riders also fighting out for their Polish Olympic selection.
And I have to say, the gap between Maximilian and the rest of the fleet is looking a bit empty without Valentin Bontas there, who had a little crash earlier on lap one. So Valentin isn't really in the running for these for the top places in this one. But it's cool seeing some new faces up front. And like I say, Maximilian Zakowski doing such a good job up front there. Incredible pace from the Polish rider. And Bruno Lobo, who loves these conditions, I think he spends his life on a 15 meter in Brazil. And we've seen some incredible race wins from him earlier in the week in qualifying.
Well, it's certainly showing, isn't it? Bruno Lobo said that he feels really comfortable in these conditions. And some of the riders that have been training in Fuerteventura over the winter, they loved it in Fuerte, but the water was so kind to them. It was so easy that this has been a bit of a shock to them, finding this ventilation style of water that they've come across here in Marmanor.
Well, guys, I'm going to say it like this. I was in Australia mostly all winter, and believe me, you love ventilation instead of hitting a shark or something. So I definitely take ventilation over a shark any day of the week, because we've seen many, we've hit many, and fortunately, well, not fortunately, I'd have to say I'm the fastest guy to get on after a crash, to get back on the foil after hitting a shark. I've never done it so fast in my life, and I think that's a beautiful skill for the race if you hit something. Hopefully not, but
so if we have any sharks in the water at the Olympics, you know what to do. You know how to get back on that board.
No, we don't want sharks. Believe me, guys, it's a terrifying thing to experience while kiting, seeing something massive just next to you coming. But I did Google it, and they mostly have bull sharks there, which I've Googled, and I'm faster than them, so.
Tony Bodichet, faster than the bull shark. That's great.
We're going around 40 kilometers an hour, so we're just a bit faster. Hopefully not crashing into taxi driver.
All right.
Maximilian is certainly faster than a bull shark right now, with 24.6 knots upwind, pushing on 25. And that top four has remained up the beat here. So we've got Maximilian Maeder in first, with Maximilian Zukowski in second, Bruno Lobo third, and Jan Marciniak in fourth. They call him the Polish Mountain back in Poland. And he is, he's a force to be reckoned with. He's progressed so fast over the last year or so.
So it's the double max show at the front of the fleet as they come up to the top mark for the final time. That's the last tack of the afternoon that Max Maeder is going to have to perform, provided that everything goes well for the rest of this race. He's on the final run down to the finish.
Oh, it's amazing. Look at this video. He's alone.
if only you were there too, Tony, you'd be giving him a run for his money, would you?
I will say it like this. I can't wait to get back on the water. I'm feeling good. I'm feeling fast. And hope you guys are ready.
So you're going to be joining them at the Princess Sofia Trophy in just over a week's time in Palma, Mallorca?
Yes, correct. So getting in some warm places, warm water. Stayed in Australia. We had 40 degrees now, and that's amazing. Seeing you guys here on the beach picking up 11 meters, still some, still 15s. Must be pretty windy out there. We see the white caps, and it must be hard for the guys skipping on the 15s, but that's just what you got to do to be one of the best.
Well, we're seeing the Silver Fleet getting ready on the beach in front of us. They're about to go racing after Gold Fleet concludes shortly. Max Maeder coming down to the bottom of the course. This is the last of four races that we've covered in Gold Fleet today. And Sunday, the final day, we'll see one more Gold Fleet race for the men and the women, and then we'll see the 10-rider medal series. And even though Max Maeder will carry that yellow bib through, and he'll carry the advantage of two race wins through with him, he doesn't have anything in the bag yet. That's the beauty of the medal series format.
It's still anybody's game. It's really hard for everything, because anything can happen. The first time I've encountered the final... we just had AP down for the others. The first time I've encountered the final format, I've had something on the foil, and that was, I think, 2021 in the Worlds. I was going third in the semifinals and just lost everything there. And it's really hard, but that's just the fun of it, and just the pressure until the very, very end is also beautiful for the spectators, for everybody to see. Max almost coming down on the last buoy, starting to jive. Max jive. He doesn't listen to me, but okay. Okay, still in front, even though we got the other guys in the back. Max with a clear lead. Max, if you're listening, or any of your family is listening to this, we have somebody here who has to say something.
Come back!
Oh, that was loud. His little brother cheering him on, Jay here with us. And Max says, amazing. Congratulations for today. That's a nearly clear win. It's good to be Max today, because also Max Zakowski coming in on second. Bruno Lobo, the Polish Mountain on fourth, and Connor Bainbridge on the fifth. Wow, look at Wojta coming in on number six here. Well, let's see if he can keep it up. There's a lot of guys coming there.
Max practicing his celebration there, and he lands it. I know he's done a few jumps in the past that haven't gone so well. But there we go. Something else he's been working on over winter, the celebratory jump. Beautiful stuff from him.
Very, very nicely done. And Max Zakowski, a great way to finish the afternoon for the Polish rider. A good round all round for the Polish, with Jan Marszynak in fourth place, just behind Brazil's Bruno Lobo, and Conor Bainbridge in fifth place. We'll go to a quick break. Back to you shortly. One:35 to the start of what will be our final race we're covering this afternoon. This will be the fourth and final women's gold fleet race. Now, just as we've seen Max Mader, the reigning world champion in the men, win all four races this afternoon, so we've seen Lauriane Lo, the reigning women's world champion, win all three races so far. So will Nolo be able to make a clean sweep of it this afternoon?
This is gonna be the last day race of the day for the girls, which is gonna actually mean a lot for Poema and Jesse, both looking at 30 points, same points going in for tomorrow. And this is gonna be a battle of the Frenchies, eh?
I wonder if they'll just go for completely different strategies, opposite sides of the course, or if they will just be match racing from before the start gun even goes.
What do you think, Andy? I'm thinking match racing, because I can see the girls, they're fighting, they're full on. They're not letting the other go. It's not our team.
35 seconds to go. We'll see how they line up against each other. I can't even begin to imagine how you do a match race at high speed with these kind of boards. But you're the two experts. That's why you're sitting next to me. Let's see if we do see a match race between Newland and Catman. And maybe that gives some justification to the match race we saw earlier on in the day. We got 10 seconds to go. Let's see if these women have listened to Tony's coaching. Are they going to hit the start gun on the beat of bang, 2-1 go?
Some of them did. That's good. They're listening. We're loud enough.
And it's Jessie Campman winning the pin there. When she has a plan, she goes for a full send, and you can see she wanted the pin, she wants that left hand side, and she is going to give it everything she's got. Meanwhile, Poema Newland in the middle of the line there, and who's it going to be? We shall see.
Nah, it's an amazing race, meaning a lot for a lot of girls. Lolo in a clear lead with the points, but still anything can happen with two DNFs or two DSQs.
And if I told you that there's a couple of riders going out to the right, I bet you can guess which one of those, that there might be one of those going out to the right. It might be Maya Ashkenazi from Israel. She absolutely loves the right-hand side. And I have to say that to some extent, she's made it work as well. It does seem like it works fairly well for her.
She did, but just getting a good start and getting lucky on going on the right side, well, like I said, can be luck, can be skill. Luck is also a skill, but She's got to keep it up. She's got to keep consistent the rest of the race. You don't win a race in the first upwind, nor do you win a race on the start. So these are the two things where you should push, but be careful not to end the race before it starts.
Meanwhile, here's the really fierce battle out to the left-hand side of the race course. Now we must be getting close to ley line. Lauriane Nolo and Paoma Newland are right up there on this side of the racetrack.
Maya looks really good on the tracker. Let's just hope she nails the ley line, because if she does, she can get on pretty well. With a tech less, saving about 3 seconds is massive.
So Newland looks like she's got the advantage at the moment, but also...
Oh, not letting them tack. Look at this. The girls are ruthless. Somebody managed to get through, is far out. That's Poema. That was an amazing job from her. But the others, they were hoping that they would just let them pass, but they were wrong. Now look at this. It looks like a line with Poema in front.
It does look like Poema Newland has the advantage. I wonder, has she hit that ley line already?
Doesn't look like it. I'm pretty sure Poema is in a beautiful spot right now. We have to see Maya how she makes it around the mark, if she makes the ley line or not. They were tacking a bit early for how it looks on the tracker, but they know more than us being out there and feeling it for themselves. Oh, look at this. Maya coming amazingly, but a bit low. Let's hope for the best for her.
And Elena Lengweiler as well, just above Maya there, both out on the right-hand side.
Looking at it, Elena can get really well out here. Maya had to tag. That's why Elena can now go forward. If she makes it, she's just on the line. She's going, look at this, amazingly going straight over everybody. Go fast. Don't let them tag. Come on. Oh, she's gonna go. Is she gonna pass them? They were so close. Ah, shit. Was scared to go inside. That could have been very dangerous, but very good. No. Sorry, that's my bad. That was the earlier boy.
Very, very close. But in the end, it's Lauriane Nolo who comes out around in the lead. It's very close.
Poema has got a better slingshot.
Yes, you're right, Tony.
She's going amazingly. It's like the same few names being mentioned over and over again.
So it's very close between the front two French right now, Nolo, and just to leeward of her, Newland. Now, Newland is in the controlling position now. She can dictate when the next jibe is. And behind her is Elena Lengweiler from Switzerland. Maya Ashkenazi up in fourth place.
So hoping that the other side, the right side of the course, gets her some better wind. Like she got on the upwind. This is amazing. They're going so fast on the downwind. I can say firsthand, downwinds are scary. You don't know what's in the water. You can't really, you don't have time to look in front of you. Anything can happen. So guys, keep the world clean, recycle. Don't throw any of your trash out. I've hit firsthand plastic bags in the water and...
And sharks.
And sharks, but I prefer to hit a shark or no.
That's a difficult question. Shark or plastic bag? It's like rock and hard place question, isn't it?
I have to say I prefer to hit a plastic bag.
Yeah, for sure.
Because a shark, a plastic bag is not going to bite back.
Well, fortunately, there doesn't seem to be too much trash in the water here in Marmanore. It's been very clean water here, and I haven't heard any complaints about weed or anything else. Just a little bit of cavitation for whatever reason that is. But Poema Newland managing to hold off Lauriane Nolo. So great sailing by Newland. Is this the breakthrough?
She's going to be close. She has to avoid.
That was Ellie Aldridge, I think, coming in.
That might have been a protest coming from starboard to port, but I don't think they were in the mark room, being those 30 meters around the mark when the first person has right of way inside.
Very close between the front three or four. It's between Newland, Nolo, Lengweiler and Aldridge as they go around the bottom mark.
Looked like a very nice rounding for many. And the guys, the other girls coming in. Looks like it's going to be clean round markings. Mark rounding, sorry guys.
Israel's Maya Ashkenazi and Gail Zuckerman right together as well in that battle for Israeli selection.
Poema's looking pretty good with the height, with the speed.
with the positioning she's in. Did we have a crash? No, we did not. But Poema is above, but a little half a knot slower. Will that matter enough for Lauriane to pass, to make a Maximilian, or will she get a second?
Poema Newland holding the lead ahead of Lauriane Nolo. This is a really important psychological moment for Newland. She really needs to take a race win off Lauriane Nolo, and also importantly needs to make sure that she gets through to the tomorrow's medal series final in second place, because that means she'll book her spot straight in the final, whereas Jessie Campman will have to fight her way back out of one of the semi-finals.
Yeah, we don't really know where Jessie is at the moment. Her GPS tracker isn't really working, with Lolo having some hard crashes, not super ones, but just enough. Poema made the drive that she didn't make in the first race on the first stack. So that's amazingly there. Well, I hope the guys don't really affect the foils with the boats going over the course. And just stay confident. Don't crash. I'm sure there's a lot of pressure on the girls here, but Poema's looking pretty well there.
Absolutely. I think she's shown us that she's capable of winning races, and she's been wanting a win today and it hasn't quite come together, but this race is looking good. She's got a comfy lead. She's keeping it together. She has the speed.
But
she's giving Lauriane a run for her money.
It's not over until it's over. Anything can happen. You can always crash. You can always injure yourself. So I'd like to encourage all of the girls, especially the Frenches now that are fighting now, and there might be a decision made after this event to still continue doing the sport they love, because anything can happen at the end. Somebody might get injured. Like, take me for an example. I'm pretty sure I'm going to the Olympics for Slovenia, but if anything happens, my dad is there and waiting with the gear, knowing how to tie and drive Raiko to go to the Olympics, and he'd love that in a way.
We're
having some crashes from just a little bit in the back. It's hope this doesn't affect the girls so much, having boats in the water, having to go around. Poema's losing quite a lot here.
And we've got Elena Lengweiler with a really nice high mode, just climbing up on the girls. That would be such an interesting pack into this ley line.
If she can push the other girls to attack, that can be so good for her. I'm stacking last.
They've all had to avoid those kites in the water there, which makes things a little bit more interesting. We've got Poema still in the lead, Lauriane Nolo, Elena Lengweiler. That is our top three at the moment.
Yeah, but look how much Poema lost because of that. That's so hard when you can't do anything about it. Lolo trying to go in, not really for speed. It must be pressure. Pressure is on. It's full speed till the last one. Is Lauriane gonna make? Is she gonna keep her bullets, or is she not?
Let's find out. Newland in the blue, still holding a narrow lead ahead of Lauriane Nolo on the left in the yellow, and also very, very close, Elena Lengweiler from Switzerland having a fantastic race, and Ellie Aldridge up amongst the front few. And just back from there, Gail Zuckerman marginally ahead of Maya Ashkenazi in the battle for Israel selection.
Lauriane is getting her cut up. This must mean for Poema, is she tacking? Is she not? She doesn't know. She can't see.
Here goes the jibe. It's going to be a simultaneous jibe between the front two French.
No crash for Poema. It looked very sketchy. But okay, they're through.
And we see now.
They're going really fast. 30 knots. Let's just hope we don't have any crashes, because then those can be fatal.
Well, let's hope not that. Bad, but not fatal. And then Poema Newland still managing to hold off Lauriane Nolo. Just over 30 knots of boat speed. And at the moment, Newland marginally faster than Nolo, although it looks on the screen we're looking at now, it doesn't look like there's much in it in terms of speed. And further over,
I don't think that's the ones, because I can see my sister there and she's in silver, so I think that's from the trackers for the silver already. I think that's not the right place to look at it. We're looking at it on computer. Poema going 37 knots while Lauriane is going 29.8.
this is going to come down to the wire. I think the final jibe, the final reach.
Okay, the drive for Poema is clear.
Here comes Newland. This could be the moment. Finally, someone takes a race off Lauria Nolo. If she can just keep it together for this final reach to the finish, it's going to be France winning all four races this afternoon in Goldfleet here on day five of the Formula Kite European Championships. But on this occasion, it's going to be Poema Newland in the blue who takes the race win just ahead of another Frenchwoman. It's the reigning world champion Lauria Nolo having to settle for second. But look how happy Newland is to have won that race at last and broken the clean sweep of Lauria Nolo, who won the previous three races, with Ellie Aldridge also doing very well, and Lily Young, both two Great Britons up at the front, along with Gail Zuckerman of Israel and Daniela Moroz. But the French proving absolutely dominant. The one that we didn't see, of course, Jimmy, was Jessie Campbell. We didn't see her in that race. So that surely means that she drops down to third, and that the two that will go through into the medal series tomorrow are going to be Nolo and Newland.
But didn't we mention earlier there's another race, another Goldfield?
Well, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I need to confirm that. So it could be that there is another Goldfleet race tomorrow. I need to check on that.
A beautiful shot here of Poema Newland and Lauria Nolo, both absolutely stoked that they can go straight through to that final in positions one and two.
So
relieved that they don't have to do any more battling in the medal series.
Just heard that there is only a medal series tomorrow. So you make it through to the top 10 and you live to fight another day. Or if you don't make it through to the top 10, then today was the end of your competition.
Exactly. You guys think I would be allowed to go straight to the top 10?
No way. You have to earn it, just like everybody else, Tony.
Exactly. And that's the fun of it. The fun from the beginning until the end, fighting the whole week. The guys must be so stoked, the ones that are in top 10, and big congrats to everybody else who didn't make it but did an amazing job. It's not an easy event. Europeans is hard, and there are 31 of the best riders here, well, 30.
And we're pleased to have you with us today, Tony.
I'm thinking of switching careers. How do you think I did?
I think you did fantastically, but we still want to see you compete at the Olympics for Slovenia this year. And of course, I know you want to win another world championship. You won in 2022. You just missed out in 2023. I remember you heading back to shore to change kite size last year in The Hague, hoping that another opportunity would come up, and then you didn't quite manage to get that opportunity. Max Mader got it squared away, but I know that you want to take that world title back from him someday.
Well, I was training hard all winter. I've been doing my preparations, doing the homework, as you'd say, and I'm feeling good. I'm feeling strong. I think I'm ready. And yeah, you just need a little bit more of event training. That's why now we're going to Palma, then to the qualifiers for the rest, and after is the Worlds, and then Paris, or I guess have to say Marseille for us, here we come. I've been training hard, and I will train even harder for every day next. Every next day is going to be harder training, so that's the way. There's no other way to do it. If I'm going to be tomorrow better than I am today, that's the way to go.
So you've given yourself a holiday this week. You're not competing. You're here sitting in the commentary box with us. Are there any other major events that you're going to sit out as opposed to not competing?
I don't think so. I'm thinking I'm doing all of the rest one of the all of the other ones. And yeah, I'm here now. I'm in it to win it, in it to do anything I can and to have fun. But yeah, I'm not letting anything pass me anymore.
Well, Tony, thank you very much for joining us today. So there is the scenario on the beach where we've got our two top French. They will be wearing the yellow and the blue bibs going into the final tomorrow. They've booked their spot in the medal series final. That's how it works. But for the other eight women in the medal series, they get split into two four-rider semi-finals. And it's the same scenario that we see in the men with Max Mader absolutely confirmed in that yellow bib, and it's Axel Mazzella who has managed to get past. It was Valentin Bontas who was lying in second, but Mazzella, the Frenchman, is now up into second, and he books his spot in the final wearing the blue bib. And Riccardo Piannozzi, the defending European champion, is now in the semi-finals along with Valentin Bontas, Conor Bainbridge, Bruno Lobo, Martin Dolence, Benoit Gomez, Yanis Mausam, Max Zukowski. So
just made it. We were talking about him earlier.
That's right. So well done to Max Zukowski. We got two Maxes in the final 10, but of course, the man in the box seat wearing that yellow bib, he's the reigning world champion. He won the European title 2 years ago in Greece. He's back to see if he can add that European title and take that trophy, stick it back in his cabinet back in Singapore. So there's our scenario for the men tomorrow. And Jimmy, Axel Mazzella, after that injury that he sustained, snow kiting, I think it was, back in January, he's been a little bit worried about his knee, but he said yesterday he's banished any worries that he has about that. He's got full confidence in his knee again.
Yeah, exactly. It must be so tough coming back from injury and being able to trust in that injured part of your body and in that recovery. And he's done such a good job this week. I think he's been a bit relieved that everything's all worked out. And yeah, as you say, straight through to that finals tomorrow.
And there's Daniela Moroz, we were just looking at there. Daniela trying out some different equipment this season. I know, Jimmy, that's been a bit of a surprise for you that she's been checking that so late in the cycle.
Yeah, for sure. I didn't ever imagine to see Daniela on a Chabanga or even an Ozone. She was on a 9 meter the other day. And yeah, I think it's good for her to kind of cover all boxes really and try all this equipment. And that she said that this event is the perfect one for her to do that. So yeah, it's interesting.
Tony, any final thoughts from today? What really stood out to you today?
Today stood out for me just to stay consistent, looking at Max, be there and do what you know how to do. Don't take any unnecessary risks. And well, I'm stealing the mic for the next minute, so I'd just like to say and also not just give congrats to the guys on the water, but to you guys as well. You've been doing an amazing job promoting the sport. And look at him, they're eating. Beautiful. Buon appetit, Max. Promoting the sport. And I don't say this from my side, whom I know how the sport works, but also my girlfriend has been saying, she's been looking at it, looking at your stories, everything you guys have been posting, and that it's really nice and nice to understand. So this has to happen for us to take the sport to the next level and bring it to the public, make them understand and see the beauty that we see in it. So thanks, guys. Keep doing a great job.
Tony, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you along and to have you, Jimmy Craythorn, two of the best kiters sitting next to me, Andy Rice. We'll just go out with women's results before we close the show. So just to say that Maggie Ellen Pichetto is the last qualifier into the top 10. So well done to the Italian just breaking into the top 10. Katie Dabson from Great Britain in ninth. Gal Zuckerman in eighth in that battle for Israeli selection. Daniela Moroz, the six-time world champion from USA, in seventh. And then Great Britain's Lily Young in sixth. Elena Lengvila in fifth. Absolute breakout performance for her. Ellie Aldridge, the best of the non-French, the British rider going to the Games later on this year. And then there are our top three. Jessie Kammer just missing out. It was a tiebreak that went against her, but Jessie's going to have to fight her way out of her semi-final because it's Poema Newland winning that last race that does just enough to get her the blue bib. But Lauriane Nolo, almost unstoppable today. The reigning world champion winning three out of four races and carrying the yellow bib and all the advantage into tomorrow's medal series final. So there we have it from Tony Vodicek, from Gemma Craythorn, myself, Andy Rice. That's it for today. We'll be back with you tomorrow for the medal series. We're going to see who's going to be on that podium for the men and the women here at the Formula Kite European Championships in Marmonore. So see you tomorrow.